From the JAMA Network, this is JAMA Clinical Reviews, interviews and ideas about innovations in medicine, science, and clinical practice.
Hello, I'm Dr. Kristin Walter, Deputy Editor at JAMA. I'm joined today by Dr. Romain Pirracchio, Professor of Anesthesia at the University of California, San Francisco. Today, we will be discussing a review article that Dr. Pirracchio co-authored recently with Drs. Venkatesh and Legrand, titled Low-Dose Corticosteroids for Critically Ill Adults with Severe Pulmonary Infections. Welcome, Romain.
Well, thank you so much for inviting me to this podcast.
Your article states that severe pulmonary infections are a leading cause of death in adults worldwide, and they may also cause septic shock and/or acute respiratory distress syndrome, or ARDS, both of which are associated with mortality rates of 30 to 50%. So clearly, optimal management of these respiratory infections is a very important issue. In the 1980s, there were a couple of studies that reported no mortality benefit with the use of high-dose steroids in critically ill patients with septic shock. But more recent studies have demonstrated some benefits with low-dose corticosteroids. Can you discuss the definition of low-dose corticosteroid and which medications and what doses are considered to be low-dose?
That's definitely an important aspect as well, because as you said, in the 1980s, the thought process was that it was mainly a pro-inflammatory response that was observed during sepsis. And again, now we know that there's like a balance between pro- and anti-inflammatory. But at that time, the goal was to really sort of shut down the pro-inflammatory response as much as possible. And in this context, people started to think of using very large doses of steroid. We're talking about 30 milligrams per kilogram of methylprednisolone, for instance, which is really a very high dose, to really shut down the pro-inflammatory response as much as possible. And the two main trials performed in the 80s that actually looked at these doses, both showed no benefit at all. And if anything, actually more complication related to that. So after these two studies, there was some sort of corticosteroid winner, until people started to realize that lower dose of steroids may be beneficial. We considered 200 milligrams per day of hydrocortisone equivalent as being sort of the normal low-dose corticosteroid regimen. And we certainly consider as low-dose only steroid doses that are below 400 milligrams per day of hydrocortisone equivalent. So this is the definition that we're using right now.
Great. So your review article discusses the effect of low-dose steroids for a variety of pulmonary infections. Let's start with COVID-19, which, as you know, has caused over 1.2 million deaths in the U.S. alone since 2020. Which patients with COVID should be treated with steroids and which should not?
The understanding that we have is that corticosteroids and low, I'm talking only about low dose again, are beneficial for the most severe forms of COVID-19 infections. And by the most severe, we're talking only about patients who are admitted to the hospital for COVID-19 with a need for additional, for supplemental oxygen to maintain their oxygen saturation above 90%. So we're mainly talking about patients with a respiratory failure that is severe enough that they require oxygen. So patients who are not admitted to the hospital, or patients who are admitted to the hospital with COVID-19 but not requiring oxygen to maintain their saturation, do not seem to benefit from low-dose steroids. The trials that have been performed during COVID seem to show that a dose of 6 milligrams of dexamethasone daily for 10 days seems to be sort of the base regimen for these patients. The question that is still open is whether or not increasing this dose to 12 or maybe 20 milligrams per day in the most severe form of COVID-19 infection is beneficial or not. There's conflicting data on that. The recommendation is still to treat with 6 milligrams for 10 days for now. But again, we're waiting for additional data to see if increasing that to 12 or 20 milligrams may be beneficial in the most severe forms.
Right. And another important group of pulmonary infections is community-acquired bacterial pneumonia. A 2023 meta-analysis that included 7 randomized clinical trials of people with severe CAP treated with low-dose corticosteroids, which included both the ESCAPE trial in 2022 and the Cape Cod trial in 2023. I was hoping you could tell us about this meta-analysis and what it concluded about the use of low-dose steroids for patients with severe CAP.
This is certainly an important indication, and the data that you just mentioned from 2022 and 2023 have really sort of changed the understanding and also the recommendation around that. So up until then, there were some small trials sort of pointing towards a benefit in terms of mortality and mechanical ventilation-free days in favor of the use of steroids for CAP. But the two trials that you mentioned, the Cape Cod and the ESCAPE trials, are the largest one by far, and again, are largely weighted in this meta-analysis. So the ESCAPE trial didn't show any significant benefit, but was underpowered. This trial was stopped for slow recruitment before reaching the sample size that was initially calculated, and didn't show any benefit in terms of mortality in the overall patient population that was targeted here, so patient with CAP requiring ICU admission. But the Cape Cod trial that came right after was a much larger trial that looked, again, at low-dose steroids, hydrocortisone 200 milligrams for 7 days with a tapering. And this study did show a reduction in mortality and a reduction in the need for respiratory support in those patients. So putting together all these studies, including ESCAPE and Cape Cod, into meta-analysis led to the results showing that, again, low-dose corticosteroids do decrease mortality in this context and are associated with a decrease in the need for respiratory support in those patients.
So at this point, are guidelines recommending the use of low-dose steroids for patients with severe CAP?
Yes, they are. And the dose and the regimen that is recommended is hydrocortisone 200 milligrams per day for 5 to 7 days. The question of whether we should use tapering or not is unclear and not clearly answered at this point. The point that seems to be important is really the timing. And in this context, it looks like starting early does make a difference. And what is currently recommended is starting within 24 hours after the first signs of severity. And by signs of severity, we usually consider either ICU admission or the need to start a respiratory support for desaturation.
So that does seem to be a big paradigm shift, which is an important thing to know about. What are the data about low-dose corticosteroids for patients with pneumonia due to influenza and RSV, respiratory syncytial virus?
So that's, again, a very interesting one because we're really lacking data in this context. I would say, in general, for pneumonia that are related to viral infection, except for COVID-19, of course, there's really no data based on randomized trials and not a lot of data based on a large observational data. The influenza infection is probably the viral infection for which we have most observational data. And all this data seem to show that steroids are not beneficial and could actually be harmful. So at this point in time, steroids should not be used in this context. For RSV, there's really very, very little data. The only observational data that are available don't seem to show any benefit of steroid either in this context.
And what about patients with pneumocystis pneumonia? Can you talk about the use of corticosteroids for these patients?
Yes, and we do have randomized controlled trials data in this context. And I would say the result that seems to be relatively clear is that corticosteroids are beneficial to treat severe forms of pneumocystis pneumonia in patients with HIV infection. Severe forms are usually defined in this context as forms of pneumocystis pneumonia associated with an hypoxemia, and you will find pretty much everywhere at threshold 70 millimeters of mercury for the PaO2 measured in room air. The question remains open in terms of treating pneumocystis pneumonia in patients without HIV infection. There is no clear data showing a benefit in this patient population, except maybe for the most severe form. But again, this relies on subgroup analysis, and there's no clear data supporting that in this context.
And one of the major complications of respiratory infections is septic shock. The 2024 guidelines from the Society of Critical Care Medicine recommend that patients with septic shock should receive hydrocortisone 200 milligrams daily, either by continuous infusion or in a divided dose every 6 hours, with or without fludrocortisone 50 micrograms enterally for 7 days or until ICU discharge. Can you talk about what this recommendation is based on, and are there clinical trials of patients with pulmonary infection-associated septic shock that are treated with low-dose corticosteroids?
Well, unfortunately, no. There's no randomized trial looking specifically at septic shock or even sepsis from a pulmonary infection. But as you said, Kristin, lung infection is by far the most common infection leading to septic shock. So in pretty much all the randomized trials focusing on sepsis and septic shock, there's anywhere between 30 and 50 and sometimes even 60% of the patients who are actually in septic shock from a lung infection. So no randomized trials looking specifically at that, but subgroup analysis of randomized controlled trials and of meta-analysis, all showing very consistent results. And it's important because in sepsis and septic shock, the results have been very inconsistent between trials. So if you compare the last big randomized trials on septic shock patients, not necessarily only from a pulmonary origin, the adrenal trial and the approach trial, both published in the New England Journal in 2018, the approach trial reported the benefit in terms of mortality of the association of hydrocortisone plus fludrocortisone, while the adrenal trial didn't show any benefit. The reason I'm mentioning these two trials, because first of all, they're the largest one, and also because there was a lot of sort of, you know, analysis, subsequent analysis to try to understand the difference between those two trials. And one of the difference may actually be related to the fact that a large proportion of the patients in the approach trials had the lung infection. And in fact, there was a pre-specified subgroup analysis of the approach trials only in patients with a lung infection, and the result was very significant in favor of the use of low-dose steroids in this context. So sort of wrapping all that up, I think we can say at this point that it is unclear whether corticosteroids, low-dose, are beneficial for all septic shocks, regardless of the origin. But what is becoming more clear based on this last results on the approach trial and the subgroup analysis is that patients with a lung infection complicated by septic shock do benefit from low-dose corticosteroids.
Interesting. So for ARDS, acute respiratory distress syndrome, which is most commonly caused by either pneumonia and or sepsis, the 2024 update of the ARDS guidelines provided a conditional recommendation for use of low-dose corticosteroids with a moderate certainty of evidence. What are the data about use of corticosteroids for patients with ARDS and specifically for patients with ARDS due to respiratory infections?
I would say it's very similar to septic shock in the sense that unfortunately there's no randomized data specifically looking at ARDS from a lung infection. So we're essentially sort of only looking at subgroup analysis of trials that looked either at ARDS or at septic shock with ARDS. So in this context, and again, I'm referring to the approach trial, if you look at the patient with septic shock from a lung infection with ARDS at baseline, those patients seem to benefit from low-dose corticosteroids. Same in the ESCAPE trial that I was mentioning before, which is again this randomized trial that looked at low-dose steroids for CAP in patients admitted to the ICU at the 2022 trial that was ended early for low recruitment. The difference in mortality was not significant, but when you look at patients with CAP and ARDS at baseline, there was a significant difference between the two groups favoring low-dose steroids in this group of patients. So we're again in a situation where we don't have specific randomized data looking at ARDS from a lung infection, but all the trials that have looked at a sort of larger population seem to show in their subgroup analysis that ARDS patients may benefit from low-dose steroids. So the other question is the timing, and older studies on the use of steroids for ARDS patients look at rather late regimen. Steroids started after a week or even 2 weeks worth of ARDS. The last data seem to show that early administration of steroids may actually be more beneficial than late administration.
And can you discuss some potential adverse effects with the use of these low-dose corticosteroids?
So again, a very important topic because we do know from general practice, I want to say, that corticosteroids do carry a lot of potential side effects and some of them potentially serious. So we essentially rely on the side effects as reported most in the randomized trials, and especially the largest one, to sort of try to understand whether or not this applies to our patient in the ICU. And the results are sort of, you know, can be conflicting, and some trials report significant side effect, others not. I would say in general, my position on that is to still be cautious and consider that all the potential side effects can actually happen in our ICU patients, especially those treated with low-dose steroids for lung infections. So hyperglycemia seems to be possible. It can be of different severity. It can just be an increase in the blood sugar concentration to a more severe form of hyperglycemia requiring insulin treatment. Secondary infections is also an important topic. Some trials, especially the largest trials on septic shock, didn't seem to report significant difference between the groups in terms of secondary infection. But trials that have looked at longer term sort of secondary infection up to 180 days after the initiation of corticosteroids report more secondary infection. The question of myopathy or neuropsychiatric complication related to corticosteroids in this patient population is still very unclear. There's a lot of conflicting data on that. And unfortunately, I don't think we can really conclude with the data that we currently have. I think we'll probably need more observational data to understand whether this is really a risk.
Before closing, is there anything else you'd like to mention that we haven't previously discussed?
Thank you so much. Well, I think the one thing I wanted to mention is that, you know, with low-dose steroids, one thing to consider is really heterogeneity in the response to treatment. And I think some of the conflicting results, you know, between randomized controlled trial seem to point towards differential response between patients. And so I think there's probably a lot to be learned in the next few years in terms of identifying and finding tools to really select the patient population that do benefit from steroids. And my anticipation is that we will be able to identify subgroups of patients who are really clear responders and who should benefit from early low-dose corticosteroids treatment. And on the other side of the spectrum, some patients who probably don't benefit and maybe should not be treated at all. So I think this is a word of caution in terms of using broadly. I think in the future, we should be a little more personalized in the way we're using this treatment.
Thank you so much for sharing your thoughts with us about this interesting and important topic. That was Dr. Romain Pirracchio, and I'm Dr. Kristin Welcher. This episode was produced by Daniel Morrow. To follow this and other JAMA Network podcasts, please visit us online at jamanetworkaudio.com. Thanks for listening.